Okay, yesterday we started with linear regression. So what we started with is the coordinate geometry and all those things. Then we realized that we can model any problem, any statistical relationship like this into a linear regression model. When I say any statistical relationship, the relationship is not clear. The points, the data points doesn't fall on the same straight line. But still we want to find out a equation in line, straight line equation. So Abhit and Jahir, if my voice is not clear at any point, just let me know. So what we are doing is we are trying to find out y equal to mx plus c kind of a variable, where y is the response variable or the dependent variable, and m and c are going to be your So m and c are going to be your slope and intercept. So instead of saying y equal to mx plus c in linear regression, we are going to call them out as beta naught and beta 1. So what we are doing is basically we are doing y equal to beta naught plus beta 1 x plus some epsilon, because we don't know. Even after modeling this under beta naught and beta 1, we don't know if it is going to directly straightforward. Is it directly falling on the line or somewhere outside the line? So the remaining piece we are modeling as a random error. So this is what we are doing. And we calculated expected value of y, assuming that expected value of e is going to be sigma square. Sorry, expected value of v, epsilon is going to be 0. So based on that, we got expected value of y. Now my expected value of y is going to be y hat, which is equal to beta naught plus beta 1 x. So if you see our y hat values, all the y hat values fall on this same straight line. So if there is any epsilon, the epsilon can be either plus epsilon, which in which case it is going to fall above the straight line, or the epsilon can be negative, in which case it could the point, data point could fall below the straight line. But all the y hats are going to be falling on the same straight line that we create in the linear regression. Is this clear? Is this part clear? Jair and Abhit, is this clear?
Yeah, yes, Sandeep.
Then I'll talk to you separately after this class.
Yeah, okay, Sandeep.
No problem. Okay. So that's what I wanted to say about the linear regression. So the linear regression, whenever we do, we are creating one line. All the y hats are falling on the same line, and all the y's. Y is the predicted value. Y hat is the predicted value. Y is the actual data point, input data point. So whenever we have y hat, Y hat is always going to fall on the same straight line that we create in the linear regression. Y is going to be falling on the either on the top of the y hat or below the y hat based on whether epsilon is positive or negative. Okay, now there is a difference with y and y hat that we are modeling as epsilon, which is our error. So this is the legend for all of our discussions. Y is the actual data point. In the actual data point, it is called response variable. X is the independent input variable or independent variable. Y is called dependent variable, or y hat is called predicted value. So we have some y, but we also predict some y hat. So the difference between the actual data point and the predicted value of y is going to be the epsilon. And I also went through the variance of y as well, where variance of y is going to be sigma square. So if you see here clearly, whenever I say expected value of epsilon is zero, I was also talking that expected of value of y is also expected value of y is beta naught plus beta one hat beta naught hat plus beta one hat plus zero. So the idea is this: whatever the properties of epsilon, the same properties will apply to y, because we are adding the epsilon to the y, epsilon to the beta naught plus beta one hat. Beta naught is chosen by us, beta one is chosen by us, x is given by the data point. So all these are going to be chosen by us itself. The only thing that we cannot choose is the epsilon. So whatever the properties of epsilon, y is going to have the same property. This you should remember, because we might do some of the interesting things in future. And I already talked about the expected value of epsilon, variance of epsilon, all these things. Errors are independent. The same assumptions that we have in ANOVA. And also talked about the derivatives and all those things. Hope you studied all these things. Now, why I talked about all these derivatives is because I wanted to optimize my epsilon. So calculus is always about minimizing and maximizing something. So what I am talking about right now is I have an error function which is sigma of x e square, and I want to minimize this error, this sum of squared errors, because sum of errors is going to be zero. There is nothing to minimize there. I am trying to do it on the sigma y minus y hat whole square, which is the sigma e square. So that's what I am deriving. So what I should derive on is I should try to minimize epsilon with respect to beta naught and beta one. So there is a small thing about partial derivatives. So what we are doing here is the partial derivative. When I am doing dou by dou beta naught, let's say, what I am saying here is I am doing with respect to beta naught. So in case I get beta 1, let's say I am doing, my function is just beta 1. Beta 1 is constant with respect to beta naught. This is the partial derivative. Actually, both beta 1 and beta naught are going to be changing. But in partial derivatives, what we do is when we are when our derivative is with respect to beta naught, beta 1 is constant. When we are deriving a derivative based on the beta 1, beta naught is going to be constant. The other value is going to be constant always. Is there any question on this?
Good, Sandeep.
You're good?
Yes, Sandeep.
Okay. So that's what I'm trying to say. So what I'm doing is I'm doing the derivative with respect to beta naught. What I'm getting? I'm extending this. Just I'm using this instead of sigma a square. This is y. This entire thing is y hat. And the square, y minus y hat is going to be the epsilon or e, whatever it is called. Okay. So now what I'm doing, I'm doing a derivative. So two times of, so whenever I do a derivative of x square, it's going to be x into 2 into x into 2 power x power 2 power, sorry, 2 into x power 2 minus 1, which is 2x. So the same thing I did, but since this is not x, this is something else, I have to do a derivative on that as well. This is the chain rule. So I am doing a derivative based on beta naught on this again. Now y hat is a constant and beta naught is, we are doing a derivative based on the beta naught only. Beta 1 is constant when we are doing a partial derivative based on beta naught. So all these are constants except beta naught. So what it happens is 2 into y minus beta naught minus beta 1 x into, only beta naught is a non-constant. So derivative of x is going to be 1 into x power 1 minus 1, which is 1. X power 0 is 1. It's going to be 1. So since it is minus 1, it is going to be minus 1. So this entire thing is going to be minus 1. What is the final equation? Sigma 2 into, this entire thing is y hat. That's what we started with. So I'm replacing it with y hat, y minus y hat into minus 1, which is equal to 0, which is nothing but sigma, this y minus y hat is nothing but e, sigma e equal to 0. I'm removing that 2 because it is the other side, it is 0, 2 and minus 1. I'm removing the constant, so I'm removing from the equation. Is that fine? So finally what I'm getting is sigma equal to e equal to 0. Are you clear, guys? I changed my headset, so I'm not sure if you are listening or not. Not if I'm talking to myself. The other thing I need to do is, based on beta 1, I have to minimize, right? Sigma e square, which is equal to dou by dou beta 1 of sigma y minus y hash. I am writing y hat as beta naught minus beta 1 x. This is square. Again, the same thing here also. 2 times of y minus beta naught minus beta 1 x into, according to chain rule, I have to do Yes, this is the mathematical background regarding linear regression. If you don't want this, just skip over. Again, the beta naught minus beta 1 x. What is with respect to beta 1, this is going to be constant, this is going to be constant. So the only thing left over is beta 1 into x.
Yeah, it would be minus beta 1.
X will be coming out dou by dou beta 1 of beta 1. What I am doing is beta 1 into x, I am doing a derivative.
Yeah.
This is going to be 1. This entire thing is going to be 1. 2 times of this y minus y hat. Same thing, right? Y minus y hat is e. This entire thing is e. This is y hat. This is y. Y minus y hat is e. Now, dou by dou beta 1, this is going to be 1. So, e into x. So, what I should do? First derivative, I should equate to 0, right? That's what I did earlier also. Implies 2, I can take it out. X into e equal to 0. 2 times of sigma x equal to 0 implies sigma x e equal to 0. So I got two equations right now. The first equation I got with beta naught, it is sigma e equal to 0. Second equation I got sigma x e equal to 0. These are the basic formula for regression. Okay. These are called normal equations or something. I don't remember the names or not. But these are very important. Is that fine? Till now? We have more derivation actually.
Yeah, it's fine.
I think one question, Sandeep.
Yes, tell me.
So the y minus beta, you know, the entire thing is e, right?
Sorry, what is it?
Yeah, here, the sigma e square, y minus y bar. So what happens to the minus? That doesn't matter, right? Just because.
It doesn't matter, right? Because it is minus 2 times of e equal to 0.
No.
Minus 2 times of sigma e equal to 0. So it is sigma e equal to 0.
Okay. So what does this mean, sigma e equal to 0, when you do derivative?
Sigma e is equal to 0 is the same thing that we learned. It is the same thing, right? Sum of all errors are 0. Sigma x minus x bar or sigma y minus y bar is 0.
Okay.
Sigma y minus y hat equal to 0. This is the same thing that we know. We already know this, right? This is the assumption of linear regression. But we got it as an equation. So it means that we are doing correct.
Okay. And the next one, Sandeep.
Don't worry about that. We are going to use those formulas to find out beta naught and beta 1. That is our purpose, right? Yeah. We don't want to do all these things, actually. The only thing why we want to do all these things is, after all these things, finally, we want to find out what is beta naught, what is beta 1. Then only we can find out one regression equation. Like I said, you can have infinitely many linear regressions because you don't have to pass through all the points. All we want to do is we want to minimize the error, even though we don't pass through any of the points. Which one is minimum out of all these things? I draw like 3 or 4 lines. We don't know. So that to make that easier, we learned calculus. We tried to minimize the error. Now the only thing is we have 2 different variables, not 1 variable. So if we have more than 1 variable, this is called multivariate calculus, which I didn't introduce much next year. But in multivariate calculus, you can use the partial derivatives.
Okay.
So that's where I did 2 partial derivatives because I have 2 variables. Then based on these, the final equations, what it will do is, it will minimize the error. That is what is my calculus theory is telling. Okay? Is that your question or I am talking something else?
No, that was my question. And the second follow-up question was sigma x into e. That is also zero, you're saying.
Yes. Sigma x into e equal to zero. This is not supporting any of our assumptions of linear regression, but this is a new equation that I found out.
Okay.
Don't worry about this. Based on these two equations, now I am going to solve for beta naught and beta 1. That is more important.
Okay.
But these are important because if someone knows regression very well, they might ask what are the normal equations of simple linear regression. Then you should talk about these things. Okay? That now you know how to derive these things as well.
Yeah.
Yes.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to solve for beta naught and beta 1. That is my final purpose. Without beta naught and beta 1, I don't know which beta to use. Which line to use. So your beta naught and beta 1 are going to define a particular line, one line. So that's what I am trying to find out. So how to find out? So let me call this as 1 and this is 2. Now you'll have more equations. And don't worry from here if you don't understand. Actually it is fine. But if you want to understand, you can always question me. But this is easier problem, actually. Let's see. So sigma e equal to 0, I am writing like this. This is y hat, this is y minus y hat is going to be e. This is what I was telling from the beginning. So from 1, I am getting this. So I am dividing this. Sigma y minus sigma beta naught minus sigma beta 1 into x equal to 0. Now sigma y minus, if you add beta naught n times, if you have n data points and beta naught is going to be constant, right? So if you add the same beta naught for each of the data points, so for the first data point you did the same beta naught, you added second data point, you added the same beta naught, something like that. If you do, when I say sigma, it means that I equal to 1 to n, right? So I am adding the same beta naught n times. What happens? It will become n into beta naught if I remove the sigma. Is it correct?
Yes, Sandeep.
So if I add 2 sigma I equal to 1 to 10, what I am doing, 2 plus 2 plus so on 10 times. So what it means, 2 into 10 times, basic formula. So that's what I am doing here. Similarly, if I add 1 plus 2 plus 3, it's going to be 6. And if I add 1 plus 2 plus 3, each multiplied by, let's say, some 5. 5 into 1 plus 5 into 2 plus 5 into 3. If I do like this, I can do 5 into sigma of I 1 to 3. I equal to 1 to 3. This is nothing but sigma I 1 to 1 is I equal to 1 to 3, right? This is same as 1 plus 2 plus 3. When I say sigma I equal to 1 to 3, it's going to be 1 plus 2 plus 3. What I'm doing is sigma I into 5 I'm doing. I equal to 1 to 3, I into 5. What I can do, I can take out this 5, then say sigma I, if this phi is a constant, I can take out this constant. Similarly, here also I can take out this constant and do sigma x equal to 0. Is it clear? So,
Sandeep, how you are constantly adding the beta naught n times? Because previously you said beta naught will expected value of beta naught will become zero, right?
Yeah, good question. I expected this. I wanted you to ask this question. So the reason is, so here I don't know the line equation. I am trying to find out the line equation. For that, there are n different lines, each one like this, one like this, one like this. There are n different lines. I want to minimize the error by fixing one beta naught. So what happens after this bit, I do this equation is I fix a beta naught. Are you getting it? I am minimizing this sigma e square by fixing one beta naught. Similarly, I am minimizing this one by fixing one beta one. Now, after these two equations came in, what I can safely assume is my beta naught and beta one are fixed. Is it correct? Right?
Yeah, so you can assume only beta naught to be constant because beta one is going to be variable, right? For this equation.
I can assume because if I combine these two equations, if I assume that these two equations are going to be there, I can assume this one is also constant because while deriving this one, earlier I assumed that beta naught is going to change, beta one is going to be constant. That's what I did for the partial derivative, right?
Yeah.
So this is already constant, this I am fixing. Now this is already constant. Here this is already constant, this I am fixing. So by this time, both are constants in both the equations. Are you getting it?
Yeah, I understood what you're saying, but for the whole equation, we're expected value of y. The only thing you're saying is the variable, the epsilon's nature that you said will y emulate. That is the only thing that will expected value is going to equal to zero.
I did not understand your question. Can you repeat?
Initially, you said, in the 5 minutes ago, you said y is going to imbibe the nature of epsilon. So y is going to follow epsilon's nature. Now that you have fixed beta on beta one, so now we are saying expected value of y is pretty much zero because the other two are constant. Correct.
No. Expected value of y is not zero. I already derived that, right? When I said y is going to emulate the behavior, if epsilon is following normal, y will follow normal. This is what I wanted to say. Okay. But y is not going to follow the values. Y is going to follow its behavior. This is what I told, right?
Okay.
Expected value of y is given by, so who is giving the y values? The nature of the data is going to give the y values, right? The data is going to give me the y values. I cannot enforce constraints on the y. Okay. Because that is the nature of the problem itself. I can enforce the constraints on error because the error comes from the modeling of my problem. The error comes from this, right? Which line equation I chose. That comes from, error comes from that. So I can enforce constraints on beta naught, beta one, and E, but not others. Okay. I cannot enforce on, for example, Y or X. because that is a given problem itself. I cannot enforce. You have to give the problem like that only. I cannot say so. Okay. Is this clear? But why beta 1 is a constant and beta 0 is a constant? After these equations, all of them get constant.
Okay.
Okay. Now I am dividing this entire data by n. Sigma y by n. If I divide by n, it's going to be beta 0. If I divide by n, it's going to be beta 1 into sigma x by n equal to 0, which implies this is going to be sigma y by n is nothing but y bar, right? Average y, average of all the y's, minus beta 0 minus beta 1 into x bar equal to 0, which implies I can solve for beta 0. Beta 0 is nothing but y bar minus beta 1 into x bar. Okay, this is the formula you should read. Is it clear? Derivation for beta 0?
Yes, Sandeep.
Derivation for beta 1 is a little bit more complicated, but we'll solve, it's not an issue. What I am saying, sigma x into e equal to 0, which means sigma x into y minus y hat equal to 0, which implies sigma x into y minus beta 0 minus beta 1 x equal to 0. Is it clear until now? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use beta naught formula. Beta naught is nothing but y bar minus beta 1 into x bar. Y bar beta 1 into x bar minus beta 1 x equal to 0. X into y minus x into y bar minus, I am multiplying the x inside, beta 1 into x into x bar minus beta 1 into x square. Don't worry about the lengthy derivations if you don't understand. But if you understand, I would suggest to follow. Okay. Let me see how to do it. I don't know how. Always confusing for me also. Okay, what I can do is I can separate this part equal to minus sigma beta 1 into x bar minus beta 1 into x square. I am separating these two into one term, these two into one term. What I can do? I can take out x here. I can take out beta 1 into x here. Sigma x into y minus y bar minus sigma beta 1 x into beta 1 x into, actually this is correct or not, this is plus, sorry. Is a plus x bar, something wrong actually. Just hold on for a second actually. This is y bar. Okay. This is actually beta naught is y bar minus beta 1 into x bar. So I'm substituting here, so it will be minus y bar plus beta 1 x bar. So where it will be plus, here it will be plus. I took off minus. So this will be minus and this will be plus. I should always get x minus x bar, that's why I could trace back. This will be x minus x bar. So what I'm doing, I'm trying to find out beta 1. So I can take out beta 1 here. I can take out beta 1 here. So what I can do? This side it is sigma x y minus y bar equal to beta 1 into sigma x into this sigma x into x minus x bar. So what is beta 1? Beta 1 is nothing but sigma x into y minus y bar by sigma x minus x bar. Is that okay, this derivation?
In the denominator, there will be sigma x or oh, okay.
Yeah. Till now it is clear?
Yes, Sandeep.
Actually, my derivation is still not done. It is half of the derivation. This is a big derivation, sorry for that, but I cannot help. So what I can, there is another intuition that I can give. It's not intuition, but this is also part of derivation. You know that sigma x minus x bar is going to be zero. So what I am doing is I am multiplying by x bar on both sides. This I am calling it as 3. This 3. I am multiplying by x bar on both the sides. X bar into 0. Which is nothing but sigma x bar into x minus x bar equal to 0. Can I do that? This is 4. Another intuition is sigma y minus y bar is also going to be 0. Now again I am multiplying by y bar on both the sides. What it will become is this one. This is 5. What I am doing is I am adding zeros on numerator and denominator. Can I add? I can add plus zero like this, right? I'm doing that actually. To simplify this formula, not to complicate it. It is only to simplify this formula. Okay? What I'm doing is I got 3.
I didn't understand equation 4.
Equation 4 you didn't understand?
No, below that. Yeah, sorry, equation.
This one?
Five.
Equation 5 you didn't understand. 5 you didn't understand. So yeah. You also have sigma y minus y bar equal to 0, right? See, if you subtract from average from every value, every of the observation, you are going to get 0. The same thing. So what I'm doing, I'm multiplying by y bar on both the sides. Since y bar is a constant, I can bring it in. I said y bar into y minus y bar equal to 0. Sigma y bar into y minus y bar equal to 0. Same as this. This is same as this. Instead of x, I am saying y here. Is that correct?
Yeah.
The same thing. Nothing different actually. So what I am saying is I am adding 0 on the both the side, both numerator and denominator, because this is 0, this is 0. I can add them on the numerator and denominator to try to simplify the formula. So what I'm saying is, what is the numerator? Sigma y minus sigma x into y minus y bar. Sigma x into y minus y bar plus, instead of 0, I am substituting this one, the below formula, 5. Y bar into, can I do this? I'm doing something wrong, 1 second. Okay. Sorry, actually here also, there is a reason for this, you get to know. Here also I should multiply by x bar. I can multiply anything. This is 0, so I mean, this is a constant, so it will go inside the sigma. Are you clear on this? Instead of multiplying by x bar, y bar, I am multiplying by x bar. Just to make things simple. So what I'm doing is this sigma x bar into y minus y bar. This is 0, so I can add. What is the denominator? Sigma x into x minus x bar plus sigma, again I'm adding 0 here. This is 0, so I'm adding this 0. Sigma x into x minus x bar. Sorry, sigma x bar into x minus x bar. I can take the sigma common. X into y minus y bar plus x bar into y minus y bar. Sigma x into x minus x bar plus x bar into y x minus x bar. So based on this, what I can say, I can take this y minus y bar common, then what this will become is, if I take y minus y bar common, it, the remaining thing will become x minus x bar, sigma y minus y bar into x minus x bar. Or I can write like this also, so the same thing I can write reverse, right? Sigma x minus x bar into y minus y bar. Let me write that, that is easier formula.
Plus or minus, Sandeep?
Which one?
X minus x bar, right? Or x plus x bar? Here, in the last statement.
Okay, sorry. This is minus. I'm subtracting by...
Okay.
And subtracting by 0, anything is fine, right? Both are same.
Yes, Sandeep.
Either I subtract or... Okay. This one is going to be, again, x minus x bar, I am going to take common. The remaining thing will be x minus x bar again, which I can write it as x minus x bar whole square, sigma x minus x bar whole square, right? I am writing it as x minus x bar whole square. So what is this one? Do you remember the covariance formula? Fxy. This entire thing. This entire thing is fxx. You remember covariance? So beta naught. Sorry, beta 1 is going to be fxy by fxx. Do you remember this formula or not?
Yes, Sandeep.
I can write this as, if I divide by n minus 1, fx by fxy by n minus 1 by fxx by n minus 1. If I do the, like this, what is this one? Covariance of x comma y. What is this one?
Variance of x.
Variance of x. Okay. This is the reason I was telling you need to know the background mathematics very clearly. Okay. Is the derivation very lengthy or confusing anywhere? This is only for your understanding actually. Because I can directly write this formula and get over it, but the problem is you will not get how that sigma e equal to 0 will come into this one. Sigma x e equal to 0 will come into this one. You don't know. Is the derivation clear?
Yeah, Sandeep, yeah, no problem. In the last first derivation, like sigma e equal to 0, there we got beta naught equal to y minus beta 1 into x bar. So beta naught and beta 1 have hats or only normal beta naught, beta 1?
These are hats. Anything that we estimate is hats. Okay,
all right.
Just for writing, I cannot put all these hats.
Yeah, no problem. I got it, sir.
Anything that we estimate is going to be hat. Anything that is population value, that is not hat. Unfortunately, we cannot do without estimating, right? So that's why any formula that you see on beta naught, beta 1, that's going to be on hat only, unless otherwise specified. Okay, we are going to do a problems on this. So don't worry about these derivations if you don't understand or if you don't have enough mathematical background. But these will help you to give better confidence on the subject. That confidence you will get only from this. Okay?
Yes, Sandeep.
I'm writing the final formula. Okay. This I can write it as covariance of x comma y by variance of x. These are your final, this is called simple linear regression. I'll tell you why it is called simple linear regression, but for me. Okay, these are the only things that you need to remember. But if you want more, you are interested in the derivation also, you can go with that. Okay, any questions on this?
I'm good, Sandeep.
Okay. Let's take a break of 10 minutes until 7:05. We'll come back at 7:05. Hi, Zahir and David. Are you back? Abid?
Yes, and I'm back.
Okay. Abid, are you back? Okay, let's do some problem. Let me remove all these things. And click fish. So I have two variables. One is the drug data. When I say drug data, it is how much drug I gave to a person. So this is let's say some drug X. I don't know which drug it is, but based on the dosage, how much I gave the dosage, the viral count will either decrease or will remain constant or might increase also. So for example, if he is giving only 8 grams of drug, then his viral count is 2316. If he is 17, it might decrease. So similarly, I have some, how many points I have? 20 points. So I have 20 points. And for each of the 20 points, I have an output variable, which is viral count. So the idea is this. Based on these experiments, there is some prescribed level of drug, viral count that you should have in your body. So how much is the drug I have to give to maintain that level? Is what is my question. So based on this data, a doctor might decide how much he has to give for the next patient. So the next patient might have a viral count of 5,000, let's say. How much he has to give to maintain 2,000 level? So this is the question. This is the future viral count, how much I have to give the drug to get a future viral count is going to be a future prediction, right? So for predictions, we have to use any machine learning technique. The first of it is the linear regression. So that's where we got into linear regression. So let's try to find out. The first thing we can do is we can try to plot using some scatter plot and see how the data is looking like. This is one of the exploratory data analysis techniques. Let me give all the data. Plot a scatter plot. So my scatter plot is the more, so this is the drug that I gave, the x-axis. The y-axis is seemingly it is a viral count. And you can see the more I give the drug, the viral count is decreasing. It's a straight, kind of straight line. It's not really a straight line, but it is close to a straight line. So that is when I can start using linear regression. Of course, I can use linear regression even if it is not linear, that you'll learn in future. But for now, you can know that this is a nearly straight line. You can start using linear regression. Okay? Now, with linear regression, I know that I can try to find out y equal to beta naught plus beta 1 x. I want to find out what is beta naught, what is beta 1. If I find out both of these, then I know the line equation. I can plot a line. So that's what I am trying to find out now. So what I need to do is I need to find out beta naught and beta 1. So let me do x bar, y bar, and x minus x bar and y minus y bar. These are the things I need to calculate. So what is x bar? Average of all this data. I'm copying in all the cells. 1 second, this should be constant. Same thing here. Average of all these things, but it's going to be constant. So dollar. I'm copying in all the cells. Then x minus x bar. X is this one. X bar, x is this one minus x bar is this one. All these things I copied. Now y minus y bar. Y is this one. Y bar is this one. Same thing I am copying everywhere. So these are the things I need for calculating Fxy and Fxx, right? Now Fxy is nothing but, it is multiplication of this x minus sigma x minus x bar into y minus y bar, right? So I have x minus x bar, I have y minus y bar. I have to multiply each of them and sum all of them. So there is something called sum product in Excel. You can use that. So I can give first array is x bar x minus x bar. Second array is y minus y bar. What it is going to do is it's going to multiply each corresponding element. For example, 2.1375, which is the first one, into 27.34. It's going to multiply this. And the next element also it's going to multiply, then add all of them. That's how it is going to do. This is Fxy. Fxx. This is going to be sum of squares. Excel has this function also, you can use that. This is Fxx. So now beta 1, I am calling it as B1 in Excel because I don't have beta. It is going to be Fxy by Fxx. But I also know another formula, right? Beta 1, another formula. I know another formula, which is covariance of x comma y by variance of x. So is it working or not? Let's see. Covariance, sample or population? Should I use population or sample? Sample, right?
Yeah.
So I'm copying all of these. Actually, both will work in this case because we are dividing by n minus 1 on both the side, both numerator and denominator. So even if you use covariance population also, it's going to work well. By variance sample of, same thing. Even if I use covariance or this Fxy by Fxx, it's going to work well. Now beta naught is nothing but y bar minus beta 1 into x bar. So these are the two values that I can one and look for the values only. Give 1 second. Y bar, and this is X bar, and this is going to be beta 1. Okay, my beta naught is, my beta naught is 2627.8. Beta 1 is minus 37. So what is my final line equation? It's going to be, instead of question mark, let me remove the question mark. So my final equation is going to be 2627 minus 37 into beta 1. Sorry, 37 into x. Right. No, it's not working. Let me refresh again. Okay. So beta naught is 2627. Point 0.8. Beta 1 is minus 37. Maybe I can remove 0.8 also. That's fine. So now what is my y? I mean, what is my linear regression equation is 2627 minus 37 into beta 1. This is going to be my regression equation. Is that clear? Now, what is this beta 1 and what is this beta naught? Let us specify. So, I have this, all these data points. Actually, my data points is decreasing order actually. If you see the scatter plot.
X, right, Sandeep? Minus 37 X.
X is, sorry. X, correct. It is X. So I have these data points. It's in decreasing order. What I am doing is I am fitting a line equation. It's going to pass through this like this, and it is decreasing. So what does beta naught and beta 1 signify actually? That's what is important, right? I don't know what beta naught is signifying. What is, why you are using all this stuff?
And intercept and slope.
Yes, it is a slope, but significance, let me write. Or let me write it in separate page. Significance of beta. But what, I mean, it is a slope and intercept, but what does it signify in regression? So beta naught is without treating the patient, what is my average viral count? So let's say I don't treat that patient at all. Then what is the, so I don't give any drug. drug is 0 grams. So what is the average viral count if the particular person is going to have that disease? Is what it signifies. This is actually Y hat, right? So Y hat equal to 2627 doesn't mean that everyone is going to have the same viral count. It means that everyone is going to have on average this much viral count. So they're going to have on average this much count, not the actual number. Actual number might be 3000 for one person, 2000 for another person, 2200 for another person. So on average, this will come into 2627. This is what beta naught will signify. Okay. But the more important thing is not beta 1 or beta naught. Beta 1 is more important. Go ahead. Beta 1 is how the treatment works on the viral count. So in brackets I'm writing increased or decreased. So what I'm saying here is, if I give 1 gram of drug, let's say I only give 1 gram of that medicine, how much for each gram of the medicine the viral count is decreasing? So in this case, increasing or decreasing actually. In this case, the beta 1 is negative. If beta 1 is negative, then the Y hat value will decrease, will go down for each gram of drug. If it is positive, it will increase. But based on the nature of the data, you already saw the this one, right? The scatter plot. The scatter plot is already giving you an intuition that it is going to decrease. How much it is decreasing? But how much part is not given by the scatter plot? Scatter plot will only give it is going to decrease. But on average, for every gram of drug, 1 gram of drug, how much your viral count is going down, that is not shown in this diagram. So that's why pictorially you can only find few things, not everything. With all these graphs, you can only find out only few of the things. Only after your calculations, you are going to find out that on average, for every 1 gram of drug, let's say I give only 1 gram of drug, how much Y hat is going to be? 2627 minus 37. It's going to be 2627 minus 37 is going to be 2590. Let's say I give 1 more gram, 2 grams. This is 74. Which is equal to how much? 2627 minus 74. 2553. Again, I give one more gram of that, let's say. 3 grams. How much it is? 2627 minus 2627 minus 37 into 3, which is 210 to 214. 211. 7 into 3 is 211. Is it correct? One eleven, which is equal to how much? 2627 minus 111. 2516. Now, my question is, what is the difference between this one and this one? And this one and this one? This is 3 grams, this is 2 grams, this is 1 gram. What is the difference in Y hat, the predicted value of 1 gram and 2 grams? It's going to be 37. 1 gram is 2590 minus 2 grams is 2553. it's going to decrease always by 37 count. I mean, the count is going to decrease by 37. Same thing with y hat of, let's say this is y hat 1. This is y hat 1, this is y hat 2, this is y hat 3. So now what is the difference between y hat 1 and y hat 2? 2590 minus 2553. I got 37. What is the difference between y hat 2 and y hat 3? 2553 minus 2516. It's going to be 37 again. So it means that for every 1 gram of drug, the difference of decrease in the viral count on average is going to be 37. That is what is beta 1 is going to signify. Is this clear? Yes. Are you clear on this?
Yeah, yes, sir.
So in this case it is 37. Okay, this is what is the significance of beta. Why we are using beta is because of this. It's going to signify how much your output variable is going to perform based on each of the input variables. If I increase this X is going to be the drug. If I increase the drug by 1 gram, how much your viral count is going to be affected. This direct relationship is given by the beta 1. Okay. Now, let me go into one more thing I need to mention. So I got, these are the linear regression formula, right? I got beta naught, beta 1, but I did not verify if sigma e equal to 0 or and sigma x e equal to 0. Let's verify that. What is e? Okay, I got beta 1 and beta naught and beta 1. I can now go into y hat. I can now predict y hat, right? Now you get the idea of y and y hat. Y is the initial data point that you are given. Y hat is the predicted value for the same data set. So let me tell you what it is. Y hat is nothing but beta naught. Y hat, okay, let me write that also. Y hat equal to beta naught plus beta 1 x. Actually, these are all estimated values. What is estimated? This is also estimated. Okay. Now, what is the estimated value of beta naught? It is this. Estimated value of beta 1? It is this. Now, what I am doing is, I am predicting y hat. When I have to predict y hat, what I should do? Beta naught I have, beta 1 I have. For each data point, I can substitute the x and predict the y hat. Beta naught plus beta 1 into x. This is the predicted value for the same data point, for the same drug. On average, y hat is going to be, the viral count is going to be this much. Beta naught, beta 1, A2 is correct. Okay. Now I'm dragging all these things. I'm calculating for all these drug values. For each of the drug value, I know the actual value, but I also try to predict the future, predict the same value using beta naught and beta 1 that I obtained. Now what is my error? Error is what is my prediction and what is my actual data point, right? The difference is going to be the error. So E I am keeping. Error is going to be y minus y hat. Okay, these are all the errors. Let me do sum of errors, which is sigma E, right? Sigma E is sum of errors. Sum of all these values I'm taking and summing it up, I'm getting 10 power minus 13, something into 10 power minus 13, which is going to be 0. This is very small, right? So it's going to be 0. Now what is x into e? Because I wanted to say prove that sigma e equal to 0, sigma x e equal to 0. Based on how is this e calculated? E is nothing but a y minus y hat. Y hat is calculated using this formula. So this e is going to contain the same beta naught and beta 1 formula. That's what I'm trying to find out. So is my beta 1 and beta naught correct, or did I do any mistake in the calculation? So what is x into e? X is this one. E already calculated y minus y hat. X into e is already there. I got x into e. These are x into e. Now what is sum of xe? What is xe? Sum of xe? Sum of xe is sigma xe. It is also going to be 0. That's what I am trying to prove. What I should do? I should do sum of this entire thing. 10 power minus 11. Still 0. Very small, right? 10 power minus 11. So it is still 0. So finally what I could say? Sigma e equal to 0. Sigma xe is also equal to 0. Is that clear? Where you ask this question? How come it is 0? Now yes, I proved it using the same data set that I have.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is called simple linear regression. The reason being, I am only using one variable. How many variables I have? I have only one variable as input. When I say one variable, it is an input variable. I have only one input variable, which is x. I am trying to find out y. There is something called multiple linear regression, which is like this. Y hat equal to beta naught plus beta 1 plus beta 1 x1 plus beta 2 x2 plus beta 3 x3 plus so on beta n xn. This is called multiple linear regression. For the time being, I started with simple linear regression so that you will be comfortable with the regression concept itself. Because multiple linear regression uses matrices and all those things, matrix algebra and all. So I started with this one because it is easy to understand and easy to calculate in Excel. So once you go into matrix calculations and all, you cannot use Excel, right? It's going to be tough. There is no matrices in Excel. Probably it is there, but I don't know. So it's going to be complicated actually in Excel. So once I start using all these this is called multiple linear regression. The one we are talking right now is called simple linear regression. Okay. So multiple linear regression is going to contain all these simple linear regression formulas in a single matrix. That is the beauty there. So that's how the subject is going to be. So are you okay with all these calculations? Did you get all these calculations? In fact, I don't need all these calculations, right? I can remove all these things. What I need to do is beta 1 equal to covariance of, I already did this, right? Covariance of this one. This one. Sorry. This one comma this one. By variance of x. By the way, I can use population variance also. The reason is, if I divide by n minus 1, it's going to be the sample variance. If I divide both by population variance, which is population, if this is population covariance, then I need to divide by n. So I can do that also. I can show you that. Both are same. We will go with sample standard deviation because of the no confusion approach. There is no confusion, right? Covariance population. This one, comma. This one. By variance population. I should use both the populations or both as samples. Otherwise, it will not work. Same thing. Exactly same thing, right? But if I use one of them population, one of them sample, it will not work. It's going to be different. So be careful at that place, at least. It doesn't matter if you are using population or sample for this formula, at least. For other formulas, definitely it will be different. But for this formula, it is going to be same. Instead of dividing by n minus 1, I am saying sigma Sxy by n by Sxx by n instead of saying n minus 1. That is the only difference. Okay, these are the things that you will understand only if you know the subject, right? So, yeah, one more thing. So let me talk about that actually. Otherwise, you will go into confusion, I know that. Supervised learning. What we are doing right now is nothing but a supervised learning. This is, like I said, this is the first step in the simple linear regression is the first step in all your machine learning. Half of the machine learning is used only, is based on only linear regression, simple linear regression. So, what is supervised learning? There are two things called, let's say, instead of saying supervised learning, types of learning. Actually, what we are doing is we are learning based on the data. So, what we are learning, that's what I am trying to, given a data set, or given a historical data, can we find out future data points? This is called supervised learning. The first one is called supervised learning. Given a historical data set, can we find out future output? Let me write like that. The idea is like this. I have x variables. Based on these z values, can I predict, based on these z values, given any future value of x? Let's say the doctor only tried to identify these points. He did not identify, for example, x equal to 20.5. There is no data point that is saying what is 20.5. I mean, what is the viral count for 20.5? When I give drug as 20.5, there is no point that is giving 20.5. So, how can I predict the viral count, Y, based on all these data? Is my concern. It is, my concern is not this one. My concern is not given Y, can I find Y hat? That's not my concern. The reason I did that is how much my fit is. Given this data, how much my model is performing to check that I did the Y hat on the same data set. But that's not what we are interested in, right? I already know the Y. Why should I calculate Y hat? Why should I predict for the same Y? Many times what happens is I only know X. I don't know the Y. To predict the Y, I'll go for the regression. I calculated this Y hat only to calculate this y minus y hat e, only to calculate this sum of e, sum of xe, just to show you how the theory is working, how much the theory is working. I try to calculate this, but these are not done in real time, right? In real time, what you do, based on this x values and y values, you try to calculate beta naught and beta 1. Once you get the beta naught and beta 1, what you are going to do, you are going to predict for any value of x, what is my y value. This is what I am trying to predict. Okay, this is where with the all these predictive analytics, all those things come in. So we are in the predictive analytics, so I did not announce it. So we started using predictive analytics.
So how will you calculate beta 1 if you don't have y values, and if you have only x?
No. So what I am saying is, given a, what did I say here?
No, you said sometimes.
Given a historical data set. No. One second. Let me complete. Given a historical data set, can we find y? Let me rewrite this. I don't know why it is not okay. So what I am saying is, given a historical data set, can we find out y for future data points? So given this data set, can we find for this one? There is no such point as 20.5. Did you find anything like that?
Yeah, that one I got. Okay, that one I got.
So given these points, both of these y and x, I am trying to find out for a new x, can I find out the y value? This is my interest, right?
Yeah.
What I am saying is, my interest is not this, because here y hat is not useful here in this case.
Yeah.
Because I already have a corresponding y. I say, what is y and what is y hat? Y is the actual observed value of the response variable. When I say response variable is the output variable. So y is the observed response variable value. Y hat is the predicted value. If you already have the observed value, why do you need to predict for that? All these things are useless. That's what I'm saying. These are useful only for your understanding about the subject. But otherwise, this is useful. This is useless. That's what I'm saying. All you need to find out is, for a given new x, which is not in the data set, can I predict the viral count? This is what I'm saying. Is that clear, Zahid?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't know this one. I don't know what is the viral count given this particular value, right? So that's what I'm trying to find out. Now what I do, beta naught plus beta 1 into x is 1866 something. What is this value signifying? This is signifying, given a drug dose of 20.5 grams, on average it's going to be, your viral count is going to be around 1866. This doesn't mean that he is going to have exactly 1866. No. On average, if you are giving to 100 patients, let's say, if you calculate the viral count after giving the drug, on average, for all the 100 patients, the average of their viral counts is going to be close to this. That's what it means. It doesn't mean that for every person it's going to be the same thing. That's not the how the real world works, right? So the doctor is going to give you 20.5 drug dose, 20.5 grams of drug dose. Then we are going to get 1866 viral count. But it's not going to be exactly the same thing. On average, we are going to get. But if that person is not still coping up properly, then he is going to give more medicine. That's how it is going to work, right? But this is going to give him how much he needs to give. Maybe he doesn't know and he is giving, let's say, 100 grams of bread. Let's see this. He's getting negative. Actually, negative doesn't make any sense here. Let's say 50 grams of drug, let's say 770. But the thing is, you know, some of the viruses, there is some limit on the virus amount of viral count that you need to have. There is some minimum limit. If it crosses that limit, you might not have feel healthy. You might not be able to digest the food. So there are 100 different things actually. So there is some minimum limit. So this viral count, actually there is some minimum limit below which it should not fall. Otherwise you will not be healthy also. That is also there. So to guide this doctor, this linear regression is going to be useful. If there is a prescribed limit of viral count, like let's say it should not be less than 1,000, let's say. Because actually a healthy body should also have some of the viral and bacterial count. So if it should not be below 1,000, and if he is giving 50 grams of drug blindly, the patient is going to suffer. So that is the reason why we can use this regression here. Is that clear?
Yes,
Sandeep. Is that clear what I'm saying?
Yes, Sandeep.
Okay. So this is what I have on the supervised learning. There is something called unsupervised learning. I'm just introducing what it is, how it is done. It's only you need a lot of time till you get there. Unsupervised learning. I can give you an intuition how it can be done. Can we predict something about data without training the system? So this is more like, I don't give any past data. When I say without training the data, it means without giving. This is called training actually. Whenever I give past data or historical data, it is called training. People say, I'm training the model. And they're saying training the model. It means that they are giving some past data points. Based on that, it's going to predict the future. But there is something called unsupervised learning. In unsupervised learning, it is not possible to give any past data. All you can give is whatever is the existing data you can give. Then based on that data itself, it will predict. Without giving past data. This means that I am not training the model. What I am giving is directly some data point I need the prediction for. The idea is like this. So for example, let's take Zahir. Zahir, can you open your mic?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now, okay, I have Zahir. I'll tell you what is supervised learning first. Let's say I give you an apple. I'll make you close your eyes actually. I'll not tell you what I'm giving. I'm giving you apple, orange, and some other, maybe banana, something like that. Okay, I'm giving you only these three fruits and you close your eyes and you can touch each of these. Okay, you can touch, you can smell, you can eat, all of that you can do. Can you tell which one is apple, which one is orange, which one is banana?
Yes, indeed. Because
yes, by say, you can even taste. Yeah. Based on
past experience.
Based on past experience. That happens. How can you classify this one? This is called classification, actually. How can you classify? Because you already ate apple, you already ate orange, you already ate banana earlier. Now you can taste or smell or touch, and based on your past experience, you can figure out, okay, this is apple, this is banana, this is orange. This is called supervised learning because you have past experience. You have some past experience. That experience is already in your mind, and based on that, you are able to do it. But let's say I give PS, and you did not eat, or you did not smell, or you did not even touch, or you did not even see the PS. Okay? And maybe jackfruit or something, I don't know. Blueberry or something. I don't know. None of these I even touched. I mean, you even touched, or you even smelled, or you even saw. None of these you saw. Now, my question is, can you decide which one is pear, which one is jackfruit, which one is blueberry?
No, sir.
No. But you can do some more things. You may not find out which is pear, which is jackfruit, which is blueberry. But let's say I give 10 pears, 10 jackfruit, 10 blueberry. Now, if I ask you, can you separate similar kind of fruits into one basket? Let's say I gave you 3 baskets. I said, can you separate? You don't have to worry about which is what. Just separate these 3 into 3 different baskets. It could be in any order. Okay. It could be in any order. You smell, you touch, you eat also. Don't eat. If you eat, you cannot separate into a basket. You can do anything except eating for the time being. After that, you can eat. So you can do anything, but you have to separate it into 3 different baskets. To do that, can you do without even knowing what is pears, what is jackfruit, what is blueberry? Can you separate it into 3 baskets?
No, sir.
You can, right? Why not?
But
let's say this is like.
You're suggesting that at least you get to touch or do some operation on it?
There is no operation on it. There is only you can touch, you can smell, you can press. All those things you can do.
Okay.
Finally, what you need to do is you have basket 1, basket 2, basket 3. All you have to do is all fruits of one type, you have to put it in one basket. I am not telling which one is pears you should tell. I am not telling that problem now. I am saying all similar kind or all same fruits keep in one basket, and I am tying your eyes. Can you do it? You may do it, some things you may do wrongly, that is fine. But most of the things you can keep it properly.
Yeah.
For example, maybe, I don't know, there may be one special blueberry that tastes or that smells or that feels like pear. Good. So in that case, what you do, one of these blueberry will come into this basket. That is fine. But are you going to do roughly the same or roughly the correct thing?
Yeah, most likely.
Most likely. Somewhere or other, there is some problem. Obviously, because you are tired and you don't know what is what fruit, you may not do. But most of these you will do. This is what is unsupervised learning. You don't know anything about this background knowledge. You don't have any background knowledge. You are separating. supervised learning is more like you already have background knowledge. Now you are separating it into apple, orange, banana, all these things. Okay. And linear regression is always supervised learning because you always have past data. Based on the past data, you are going to find out the future data points. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Yes, Sandeep.
Okay. Okay, this is what I have for today. Any other questions? With all our derivation, everything, supervised learning, unsupervised learning. So in supervised learning, what we do is, based on the past history, we are going to find out some model. When I say model, it can be an equation or it can be an algorithm. I already mentioned that. So in this linear regression, it's always going to be an equation. So when I say linear regression model, when I say the model, when I say that, the model is nothing but this 2627 minus 37 into x. This is called my model. Based on the data, I found out this equation, right? Linear regression model. So when I say model, based on the data, I found out some equation. Now, that equation, I am saying it as a model. Don't get confused whenever people say modeling. Modeling, I am doing modeling. Modeling is nothing but finding out this equation. Of course, in linear regression, in some other context, it will be different. Depending on the logic we are using. Okay. Now, you got your linear regression model. So, for any future data point of x, I can find out the y hat. That is my prediction. When I say I am doing predictions, I am substituting the values and in the model and finding out the y hat. This is what is the prediction. Okay. On the basic level, you got what is modeling, what is prediction, what is supervised learning, unsupervised learning, all these things. Don't worry, we'll get into unsupervised learning more. But right now, this is what you need. Even if you don't know anything, you can try to find out some patterns. That's what is so unsupervised learning. Okay. Any questions? One more thing is unsupervised learning is not going to perform that much compared to supervised learning because supervised learning, you have more information. It's as simple as that. Any questions?
Yeah.
So you are officially into machine learning. So enjoy machine learning. Okay.
Sure.
Okay. Zahir, any questions?
No, I'm good, Sandeep.
Okay. Very good. So I'm clearing off all these things because it doesn't look good in the notes for you. Okay, so let's catch up tomorrow then. Okay, I'm closing the session.